Continuing on from my lesson the other day on the key features of body plans, we need to now talk about the six phyla. Remember that I told you that there are over 30 phyla in the animal kingdom, and we are only going to learn about six of those. I would like to remind you as well that in grade 10, you did a lesson. Some of you have told me that it wasn't a very good lesson, but in grade 10, you did a lesson on classification, and you were supposed to learn that a phylum is one of the ways that we group animals or group anything really based on characteristics. So if we look at animals, they all belong to the kingdom Animalia, and then we'll get kingdom, phylum, order, class, species, we'll get genus first, sorry, and then species. Okay? And that is how we name an animal. If you remember from, or name an organism in any case, if you remember from grade 10, you learned that any organism has a name that has two names, if that makes sense. Like Homo sapiens. Homo is the genus, sapiens is the species. So phylum is just one of the groups that all these, that we grouped or that we classified different organisms into. So within the kingdom of Animalia, there are over 30 groups with different characteristics. I hope that makes sense. Okay, so we're going to learn about six of them only. Now, while I say that, that means any test question can only ask you questions about these six phyla, but we have spoken before about a cladogram or a phylogenetic tree, and I'm going to teach you a phylogenetic tree again. A phylogenetic tree might not look exactly like the one you are going to learn because it depends on which phyla they throw into the mix. If they add any other phyla into the mix, it'll change the way the phylogenetic tree is ordered. Again, that question will just be for you to see characteristics or something like that. I know I haven't covered that, so please don't worry. All I'm saying to you is that we are only learning six, and you only need to know the characteristics of those six. So when anything else gets thrown into the mix, it's really just there to see if you can understand and other basic ones that we've taught you and to confuse you a little bit. We're never going to be asking you, or no one is going to ask you about a phyla that you haven't learned, so please don't think that. Okay, so there are six phyla, as I said, that we're going to learn about. We have the porifera. Now, in its name, it says porifera, so they are pore-bearing organisms. So you think of organisms that have lots of pores, lots of holes, like sponges, for example. The next phyla is called the cnidarian silent sea. The cnidarians are known as the stingers. When you picture this, and I do, grade 11s want you to definitely picture. So you see porifera, you think sponge. You see cnidaria, you think jellyfish. Because as long as you have one animal in mind or one organism in mind, you will be able to recognize pictures based on that and characteristics based on that. So cnidarians are all the stingers, and I want your highlighted organism to be jellyfish. The third group, the third phylum, is called Platelminthes. They are flatworms. Now, plat in the beginning there of the name, I want you to think plat in Afrikaans, flat, okay? And so flatworms, I want you to think of literally a squashed worm, okay? If I had a round worm on the floor and I bloop, squashed it, it's going to end up a flat worm, right? One mush, one thin layer. Don't imagine blood and gore and guts. That's not the point. The point is to imagine that suddenly a round worm would become what am I called? The area of that worm would become more on the ground, the surface area, right? So it would be a larger, thinner worm, if that makes sense. Like a tapeworm, for example. The fourth group, fourth phylum, is called the Annelida. And Annelida are segmented worms. Now, often they also talk about round worms. And that means a worm that you can find segments in. So you think of a tapeworm. A tapeworm has more than one section or segment. The fifth phylum is called arthropoda. That is your arthropods. These arthropoda, they have an exoskeleton. I know it's not here, but they have an exoskeleton. And they have what we call jointed feet. In other words, many feet, and they somehow are joined. And your, obviously, I hope that arthropods made you think of spiders. Your example is going to be spiders. And then lastly, the group to which we belong as human beings is the phylum Chordata. Now, cord says spinal cord or nerve cord. That means we have a spinal cord that runs throughout our body from which impulses can be sent. Now, a spinal cord, as you guys know, is also surrounded or protected by vertebra, and chordata happen to be the only group in of these six that have vertebra, that have a spinal cord. And therefore, we say that they are vertebrates. They have a vertebra. The other five groups are all invertebrates. They don't have vertebra protecting a spinal cord. Okay, so we're going to break down each phylum on its own then. And we are at the stage where this hangs again. I'm sure you guys will get used to me not knowing what I'm doing, or this computer of mine hanging, or something like that. It happens when I've spoken too long on one slide. There we go. Okay, fabulous. So the first phylum I told you we're going to do are the Porifera. Now, grade 11s, I want to remind you that I've done a lesson on the key features of body plans. So I've spoken about asymmetrical and coelomate and triploblastic and diploblastic, for example. I'm not going to repeat myself in this lesson what I mean. So these next few slides I'm going to go over quite quickly because it's quite self-explanatory, right? So the Porifera, reminder that Porifera says they have pores, and I told you to think of sponges. Now, we're not thinking of SpongeBob, and we're not thinking of the sponge that you use to wash your dishes with. I want you to think under the sea, exactly like this picture, okay? Your coral. Okay, so if you have a look at this diagram, you can see that it's asymmetrical. You can definitely see there's no symmetry in this diagram. You can see that, no, you can't see it, but furthermore, in the slide, it tells you that they are acoelomate. They have no coelom. They have no gut. In fact, if you go and have a look at all the characteristics that we learned, they have none of them. They don't have a gut. They don't have a blood system. They have no symmetry. They have no coelom. They have no cephalization. So basically, if we as you'll see at the end when we put this into a table, if they, we asked if they have any of the characteristics, no. That's basically what I'm going to say to you. Because we don't, we can't just say they have nothing. They do have something that makes them up, and that would be just specialized cell layers. So their cells, each layer sort of is different from the other, but not enough to make up, for example, an organ. Okay, so we just learn it as no, and specialized cell layers. And what's more important there are my nose than anything else. Okay, the next phylum, is the Cnidaria. Now, different from the Porifera is suddenly they show some of the characteristics that we've learned about. So they still have some no's there, but they have some yeses too. So for example, Porifera had no symmetry. Suddenly, if we look at Cnidaria or jellyfishes, we see radial symmetry. What is radial symmetry again? I said I wasn't going to do this, but quickly. It is symmetry over more than one axis. Okay, so you can see radial symmetry in jellyfish. They are diploblastic. They have diploblastic tissue layers. You can go and revise what that means. And then they have developed a blind gut. Those are the three that they have new to compared to periphera. The other answers are still no, 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 no. Okay. The reproduction you can learn on your own. It's not something often that we ask. We focus on the common characteristics. So here I want you to focus on the fact that there are suddenly three things that have developed. Radial symmetry, diploblastic, blind gut. Okay, and again, if we're saying they're not made of organs and things like that, then they must still be made of something. So here we find that there is some level of tissue organization. In other words, the cells are more specialized to form tissues, layers that perform different functions. Okay. The next phyla is the platyhelminthes. Now, again, look at my diagram here. Remember I said squashed worm, flat worm with a larger surface area? There you have it. Okay. Again, let's focus on what has developed here. So in the previous phylum, we had radial symmetry. Now suddenly we see bilateral symmetry, symmetry only on one axis, right? Only on one axis. Please don't look at patterns here necessarily, okay? We're just looking at tissue and organ structure. Then they are triploblastic, three germ layers. They also show some cephalization. So there's three things that have developed that the cnidarians didn't have. That's bilateral symmetry, triploblastic, and cephalization. They also still have things in common with the cnidarians. For example, they are still acoelomate. They still have a blind gut. So those characteristics will remain. Again, I'm repeating that I'm not worried for the method of reproduction at this point. Okay. The next phylum, the fourth phylum, is the annelida. Annelida are segmented worms, round worms. Round worms, similar to platyhelminthes, have bilateral symmetry. In fact, you'll see that going forward, everybody has bilateral symmetry. We had the most basic already, which was no symmetry. Then we had the development of radial symmetry, which means more of it is the same. And then we had the most developed type of symmetry, which is bilateral symmetry. So going forward, everybody will have bilateral symmetry because we don't have a more developed type of symmetry. Okay. Also, we saw that the previous phyla had triploblastic cell layers. That is the most developed. They can only go up to triploblastic. So everybody going forward will have triploblastic cell layers. We do suddenly, though, see the development of a coelom. So that's new because everything was acoelomate up to now. We also see a through gut instead of a blind gut. Okay, I'm just repeating, I'm saying the things that are most important. I'm pretty sure you guys can read for yourself what is here. Now, something that I've left off of this slide that is important to note is that annelida have a closed blood system. That is important as well. Suddenly, so prior to annelida, we haven't discussed blood systems. But annelida have a closed blood system. That is very important. You'll see at the end of this why I'm mentioning that. Right, the rest of it you can read for yourself. Hydrostatic skeleton, grade 11s. You learned what a hydrostatic skeleton is in grade 10. So I'm not bothered about that. The fifth group, phylum, are the arthropoda. I said to you, I want you to think spiders. They have similarities to the annelida in that they are bilaterally symmetrical, they are triploblastic, they are coelomate, they have a through gut, they have cephalization. Everything, every characteristic that we discussed of the key body features, the ones that are, like for example here, the metamorphosis and the leathery exoskeleton, we didn't discuss those in key body features. Those are additional body features. But all the key body features are the same as annelida, exactly the same, with only one difference. And that is that arthropoda have an open blood system and not a closed blood system. Okay, then chordata is our last phylum that we're going to learn about. The chordata, very similar to annelida, in that they have bilateral symmetry, they are triploblastic, they are coelomate, they have a through gut, they have cephalization, they also have a closed blood system, which is not on this. What do you call it? Slide. The only additional thing that makes them chordates instead of annelida is the fact that they have a nerve cord, which is very important, obviously, for us as humans or any mammals to have a spinal cord that is protected by vertebra, which means chordates are vertebrates instead of invertebrates. So that nerve cord one is the only differing feature from annelida, for example. Okay, so those characteristics, grade 11s, no jokes. You go and you learn them like a parrot for each and every phylum. And the most important thing for you guys to be able to do is to recognize which phylum has the characteristic and which phylum does not have the characteristic. And again, the most important characteristics are the ones that we discussed with key features of body plants. The last slide here will be a little bit of self-study, just why invertebrates are important to us in our ecosystem. So that would be the five phyla excluding chordates or chordata. Okay, then I want to talk to you about phylogenetic trees. Okay, so we've spoken when we did plant diversity, we've spoken about cladograms or phylogenetic trees, and we've spoken about how these phylogenetic trees show the characteristics that develop between different groups. So just to show you that very quickly, you will remember, so here's a typical cladogram of what we learned, which was the four groups of plants. Okay, somewhere along the line, everybody has something in common. So here it shows this little first green dot is saying everybody, mosses, and everybody up this line. This is a very important line to follow. Okay, everybody up this line has the same characteristic. So whatever characteristic is here at this green dot, first green dot, mosses, ferns, conifers, which is your gymnosperms, and flowering plants, which is your angiosperms, they all have this trait. So here, the most simple thing would be that they are all plants, right? They all belong to the kingdom Plantae. Right. Then up this line, along this line, somewhere along here, this first section, a new characteristic has developed. Okay, so between green dot 1 and green dot 2, a new characteristic has developed. Meaning anything before this line doesn't have it. Therefore, mosses do not have this characteristic, but ferns do, okay? And ferns, you'll remember, were your pteridophytes. So pteridophytes, they developed some form, it was not great, but some form of vascular tissue, and so we'll find the ferns on the next group. Then somewhere between this green dot and the next green dot, a trait developed, a characteristic developed. If it's along this line, then it means whatever was before this line, so ferns and mosses, do not have this characteristic, but everything that's after this line does have it. So gymnosperms and angiosperms. And that would be seeds. So we know that the spermatophytes were seed-bearing plants. And then it divides it from seeds into gymnosperms and angiosperms. That would be because although they both have seeds, gymnosperms have naked seeds and they don't produce fruits or flowers, while flowering plants, angiosperms, do develop flowers or fruit on a closed seed, on an enclosed protected seed. Okay, so along this line, I'm going to show it to you in greater detail when we do the animals, but along this line, we have the development of characteristics, and everything from the point onwards will have that characteristic. So in other words, if you look at this green, so green dot here, it says vascular tissue. That means this from this point at this green dot onwards, upwards along this line, everybody has vascular tissue. Okay, it'll make a lot more sense just now. Okay, so here's an example of the animal kingdom, all right? Vertebrates and invertebrates. At some point, they all have something in common. Here we have Some of the ones we've learned, Porifera, Cnidaria, Platyhelminthes, arthropods, Annelida, and Chordata. Do you see how we haven't learned about a few of these, but they are grouped here? So this example is going to look slightly different to the group that I'm going to show you when we do only our six on a phylogenetic tree. Okay, but the basic here is to say, okay, they all have something in common. So Porifera all the way down to Chordata. You see, they've all found along this line. They all have something in common, right? And that would be the fact that they all belong to the kingdom Animalia. But then, somewhere where a new phylum is created, a new characteristic developed, everybody from that point where that characteristic developed upwards will have that characteristic, excluding the one before. Again, if I go up the line, the next point where a phylum is created, we have another characteristic that would have developed. Everybody up the line would have that characteristic. Anybody prior to that meeting point does not have that characteristic, and so on and so forth. That we could basically say that chordata are the closest in relation to echinodermata on this specific example, and the furthest removed from Porifera. They have the least in common with Porifera. They have developed the most. The longer the points become, the more development of characteristic that has occurred. All right, so having said that, I have made a table. First, just so that we can have a look at this table, that just s shows the key features of body plans that I've spoken about, the ones that I told you are important, the ones that we need to know, and what each phylum has. So I will send you this. It's a nice little cheat sheet, grade 11s. It's nice to study from because these are the things we're going to ask. So we have the six phyla that we've learnt about: Porifera, Cnidaria, Platyhelminthes, Annelida, Arthropoda, Chordata, in order from most developed to, I mean, I'm lying, from least developed to most developed. Okay, I've put in a picture for you so that it stimulates your visual brain, so that you can remember the kind of example. So that if I give you a picture like this in a test, you immediately associate it with the phylum. And then I've taken the main key features of body plan. So symmetry, cephalization, tissue layers, coelom, gut openings, and blood system. And I've put everything into a group. So if you remember when I started, I said Porifera have none of those things. They have no symmetry. They are asymmetrical. They have no cephalization. They have no tissue layers. They have no coelom, no gut openings, and a closed blood system. I mean, I'm lying. Sorry. My brain, no blood system, none, 0000000. Okay. Cnidaria, we said they suddenly developed radial symmetry. They also developed diploblastic tissue layers as well as a blind gut. Everything else stayed the same. Platyhelminthes, they developed bilateral symmetry. They also developed a degree of cephalization and they developed triploblastic tissue layers. The rest stayed the same. Annelida remained the same with symmetry, remained the same with cephalization, remained the same with tissue layers, but suddenly they developed a coelom. So the Annelida are the first group that are coelomate organisms. They also developed a through gut and a closed blood system. We then keep on with that pattern: bilateral cephalization, triploblastic, coelomate, through gut. I told you that the only difference between Annelida and Arthropoda, in not the only difference, but the only difference with respect to these specific six characteristics, are the fact that they have an open blood system. That is important because it almost would look like regression. I'm just going to show you on a phylogenetic tree what that would look like. But just in terms of learning it, it would be exactly the same and then just an open blood system. And then when we look at Chordata compared to Annelida, It's going to be exactly the same as Annelida, with the only difference being we would add to chordata that it has a nerve chord. The reason why it's not in this table is because it wasn't a key feature of a body plan, but it is the main differing characteristic between Annelida and chordata. So I find this a nice table to learn because if you have like a little cheat sheet, then it's none, 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 none. Then you learn only where the changes happen, and then you end up with all your characteristics learned. I like to make things easy. Maybe that means I'm spoon feeding you, and you might find the trick a little bit more difficult because you don't get spoon fed. But that's okay. I will treat you like babies, especially in this stupid coronavirus time. Okay. Then lastly, grade 11s, I've also, again, see more spoon feeding, made you a phylogenetic tree just to be able to explain a little bit better to you. But before I do that, I want you to know this is only a cladogram, a phylogenetic tree for the 6 phyla that we have learned. It can look different if we add other phyla into the mix. It can also look different if we add other characteristics into the mix. Like, for example, the ones that I ignored, like sexual reproduction versus asexual reproduction, and hydrostatic skeleton versus exoskeleton, versus endoskeleton, for example. So depending on which characteristics we add into the mix, we can have a different looking cladogram or phylogenetic tree. I want to show you this one because what you need to recognize are the 6 things plus the 1 extra for chordata. Okay, so if we start somewhere along the line, everybody, all of these 6 are animals. They all belong to the animal kingdom and therefore they are animalia. Okay, I could have just put that here as well, but I just wanted to make it more clear. At every point, please look at this red circle that I've made here. At every point where a vertical line meets this diagonal line, that would be a new characteristic developed. At the point where they meet, everybody onwards would have that characteristic. Okay, so at this point over here, from periphera all the way to chordata, everybody has that characteristic. At this point over here, everybody from nadaria all the way through to chordata has that characteristic. At the point here, for example, only chordata has that characteristic, if that makes sense. Okay, so having said that, the next thing is that the characteristics that develop, the extra things that change, the traits, if we can call them that, are found here. So this red block, these things every time show the traits that have developed. This block that I've put in yellow for you here, so each time there are 6 of them, each time there's a block, those will not be shown to you. Okay, you will never see them. I'm just, for studying purposes, trying to make this easier and explanation purposes as well. So we'll start at the periphera, okay, the most basic group. And I told you that you should remember, no, 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 no. So they have nothing. They have none of those key features of body plans. Then up the scale 1, so the next phylum, is the nadaria. So the nadaria saw the development of radial symmetry. They saw diploblastic tissue layers and a blind gut. So where everything here was no, 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 suddenly here we still have no cephalization, no coelom, and no blood system, same as here. But instead of no symmetry, we have radial symmetry. Instead of no tissue layers, we have diploblastic tissue layers. And instead of no gut openings, we have a blind gut. Okay, so at this point, everybody onwards has these characteristics, unless otherwise said. So unless they've developed a new characteristic. I hope that makes sense up to this point. Okay, then the next phylum, the Platyhelminthes, they will have all of these characteristics, as I said, except if something changes, except if they develop a new characteristic. So they did develop new characteristics, and those were bilateral symmetry, triploblastic cell layers, and cephalization. So therefore you will see radial symmetry from nadaria is no longer radial because it's changed to bilateral symmetry. Nideri had no cephalization, but cephalization developed at this point, so they do show cephalization. And where Nideria had diploblastic tissue layers, they, platyhelminthes, now have triploblastic tissue layers. But they still have no coelom, they still have a blind gut, and they still have no blood system, as with the Nideria. Okay. The next phylum, the Annelida, they will have all these six characteristics, except if something developed. So these are the characteristics that developed. Suddenly we have a coelom, we have a through gut, and we have a closed blood system. So therefore we'll see here, we already developed bilateral symmetry, so we still have bilateral symmetry. We developed cephalization. The only difference here is platyhelminthes had very, very basic cephalization. And by Annelida, the development of cephalization just kept continuing. So it got better and better. Okay. Here we had triploblastic, here we still have triploblastic. The development was, number one, a coelom. So suddenly we see that they're no longer a coelomate. We also see the development of a through gut instead of a blind gut. And we see the development of a closed blood system. Okay. Now, everybody, remember I said everybody from this point onwards will have all these characteristics. And that is why you'll see that arthropoda are not on this line. Arthropoda have every single characteristic the same. Bilateral, cephalization, triploblastic, coelom, and through gut. With the one difference being that they do not have a closed blood system. The minute that I put them on this line, if I'd put a vertical line upwards, then I'm saying they have a closed blood system. And I'd be lying if I said that. So I'm saying they have all of these, except at this point, they have something different. So just like pretend this was gymnosperms here, Annelida was gymnosperms, and arthropoda was angiosperms, it would say at this point they branched because they had many similarities except one. And the difference at gymnosperms would have been naked seeds, and at angiosperms would have been covered seeds. So here I'm saying, hold on, they have all these characteristics, but Annelida have a closed blood system, and arthropoda have an open blood system. Okay, and then following the line upwards, chordata is the last group. Chordata, you will see, have everything the same as Annelida. Bilateral symmetry, cephalization, triploblastic, what am I calling them? Tissue layers. They have a coelom, they have a through gut, they have a closed blood system. Their difference that makes them a new phyla is the fact that they have a nerve cord. Okay, so having a look at this phylogenetic tree, you can see that chordata are the most closely related to Annelida. Okay, arthropoda and Annelida are very closely related with only one difference. Chordata and Annelida also very closely related with additional features. Chordata has additional features. Arthropoda doesn't have additional features to Annelida. It just has an opposing blood system, a different blood system. Chordata has the same blood system as Annelida. It has more features. It's more developed than Annelida are. Okay, and that's, I hope that you know that you are more developed than an earthworm. So that speaks for itself. Okay, and then from this we can also see that chordata are further removed from periphera than Annelida or platyhelminthes or Nideria. Okay, and you can see that as they closer to each other, they have more similarities than further away from each other. Now, you can go and learn this stuff off by heart by based on that table. My suggestion always to grade 11s is study the key features of body plans, like I taught them. What is a coelom? What is triploblastic? What is diploblastic? And then go study the table. You don't have to go through every slide and try and remember the six things of every slide. You just go and cheat sheet a little table for yourself. Or you cheat sheet this. Here it is. What makes it nice to have either way of the cheat sheets is if you get given a question in a test with a what is this called? Phylogenetic tree, then you know how to answer these questions. It's a nice little section for marks. So having said that, I want to show you one last thing. This diagram comes from a question in a grade 11 test. I've asked it before. And obviously I didn't put the questions here, but just based on 1, 2, 3, 4, and A, B, and C, you should be able to answer this. So it says multicellular ancestor. Okay, so it's saying the ancestor of all of these animals. Okay, we can get into many debates about who that is. We're not going to do that. So if we look at number one, we know that we learned about 6, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So it must be 1 Porifera, 2 Nidaria, 3 Platyhelminthes, 4 Annelida, and then those two are filled in for us already. It has to always go from least developed to most developed. Okay, so this one is just different. Doesn't matter if it was this way around or this way around because it comes from the same branch. You can also see that this is slightly different to my one just because this would probably include additional features. Okay, so it's saying at point A, which lies between 1 and 2, there was a new development of a trait. So between Porifera and Nidaria, suddenly something developed. I taught you three things. So you should be able to tell me based on my lesson what A is. And that would be, radial symmetry, diploblastic tissue layers, and blind gut. Any of those three could lie between at that point A. Then between the points 2 and 3, we see B and C. Now, that's just confusing you because it's like A then means it's only one characteristic. So it's either blind gut or this or that, okay? But I'm listing three so that you know. So B and C is basically the same thing. So at the point B and C, you could answer any of the three things that lie between Nidaria and Platyhelminthes, which if we look over here, between Nidaria and Platyhelminthes, we suddenly had bilateral symmetry, cephalization, and triploblastic cell layers, or tissue layers. So any of those three. And then just lastly, looking at that diagram, you can see that they are here saying, everybody here has no coelom, so suddenly at this line over here, we must show that after this line, a coelom has developed. So here, we must have the development of a coelom. If you remember from, where's my diagram again? From this table, a coelom develops here at Annelida, okay? And then Annelida, Arthropoda, and Chordata have a coelom. So therefore, at this line over here, that goes to 4 and that goes to Arthropoda, a coelom develops, which is very confusing because then technically it goes up to Chordata, which is why I don't like this diagram necessarily and why I don't teach on this diagram. I want to make you, I want to make sure that you know, I will ask different types of cladograms or different types of phylogenetic trees. They won't look like the one that I've taught you, but I will never ask it in a confusing way or in a way that tries to stuff you around. You will be able to answer it based on what I'm looking for. And also, if I ask something like A or B, I'm going to say which three characteristics could have developed at B, or I'll make it more specific. I won't just make you guess. And if I do make you guess, then any three would be correct. I can't, B or C can't be either or, okay? And that's it for animal diversity, grade 11. It's really a nice section to just parrot fashion. Please don't ever tell anyone I said that. And the terrible thing is that you have video evidence of me saying that, which I've never planned on actually giving you. But there is room. If people tell you there isn't room for parrot fashion in learning, they're lying to you. So there's room. Study it like a parrot. Who cares? The next topic that you're about to do ain't going to be easy like this. It's going to be quite tough. So study this like a parrot and get your marks. Study your table. Study the cladogram, the phylogenetic tree, and know the what it means when I talk about cephalization, or how to draw a triploblastic organism or a diploblastic organism or a triploblastic pseudocoelomate versus a triploblastic coelomate versus a triploblastic acoelomate. That's the worst that I can ask you. We can either ask you a cladogram, we can ask you a few questions on the key body features, we can give you a picture of a jellyfish, for example, and ask you to name the characteristics. But if you know your table, you'll be able to do that anyway. And we'll never ask you an organism that you are like, which phylum does this belong to? It will always be one that is very easy to tell. Okay. And that is my spiel for this section. I really hope that even though I say I'm a lot and I get stuck on slides and those kind of things, I really hope that my lessons are not, you're not feeling that my lessons are just self-study. I hope that I'm making things a lot more self-explanatory or more understandable and accessible. And have a good, I don't know, if you watch this, whenever you watch this, have a good morning, afternoon, evening, whatever it is, what time it is, have a good that.